It's another beautiful day, Wednesday on Your View. Welcome to the show. I am Tokpe Mark Odige, and I never do this alone. I have my co-host here with me. Good morning, YK in the building.
Yo, good morning. Honestly, I've missed the show. You know, I couldn't make it on Monday. I was on location.
Actress YK.
Nothing
good comes to me, actually.
We were there from, I didn't sleep till 2:30 on Sunday. Whoa. I got there 7 a.m. I was there till about 9 p.m. I had to call Uwa that, I beg. There's no way I can wake up at 4 a.m. on Tuesday, I beg.
Well, you're looking really good. You don't look stressed. Tired.
You don't look stressed at all.
We thank God for makeup.
Meanwhile, I saw pictures of your celebration. The outfits were...
Have you sold yours?
No, I actually just found mine yesterday.
Roberto.
Because when they said I had one, I said no, they didn't give me. I now found it yesterday. You have a whole suitcase of material, honestly. So when I now saw the picture, I said, no, this thing, if they didn't give me, I'm not going to agree. So I went and looked and I saw it. I said,
When are we coming to your house, Mikey?
Yeah, it's you people. Maybe we're supposed to do retreats.
So, JSF, you people have. I'm tired of you people. I'm telling you.
Jumoke, you looked really nice yesterday.
Oh,
I think you were wearing a brownish.
Really lovely. Dress. Thank you.
Lovely.
Brown blends so well with your skin. Nima, how are you coping with the
It rained today, sari. And amazingly, the roads were not flooded. Somebody cleared our drainages.
We are thankful for that.
Thumbs up, like my daughter would say, thumbs up for you. And I must say happy birthday to Mrs. Tolu Ibiyinka, a friend I just made, very warm and accommodating woman. At the Home Affairs Ministry. We'll be seeing you later today.
Queen of shout outs.
Thank you.
Jibake, how's business going?
Business is doing very well. Thank God for the meeting yesterday. It was successful. Mm-hmm. Sapphire Jumoke running into
You say you just need to sneeze. Just sneeze your way.
Is that part of the jam date? I'm sick. I'm thinking about it after the first.
I just want to say something here today. I don't gossip, right? If I enter trouble, don't call Nima. Please call YK. YK is not a lawyer, but she first of all gather all the shrine boys to send everybody away first. So it's when I'm eating shrine rice, she now say, "Hey, Jumo, keki luti e shegon." That's a good friend. Nima, we come and say, "We are guilty, Jumo ke." I don't know how the collective guilt will help anyone. Thank God it was not Nima that followed me to FRSC yesterday.
Your car will be in jail. You'll be in jail.
One of us will be in jail. The first thing Nima said, surely you have Bluetooth in your car. The person who bought the Bluetooth gone with sorrow. Lataro, we're in FRSC just begging them. Unfortunately for me, again, I had put the phone on speaker. He now heard. They'll say I'm tracking. You see? But we thank God I'm now an ambassador for FRSC, and their issue is, it's not even about the penalty for you making a call while driving, because I didn't have a phone to my ears. That even though you may be on speaker, if you hear good news or bad news,
you may
lose your focus while driving. So
you can use earphones.
Yeah, it is more about the news that you hear.
No, but you see, this, the thing is, somebody can be sitting beside you, and you will be discussing.
Funny enough, so, we can really deliberate. We would deliberate over and over again. On this issue. Yes, we would always bring our good friend Igenius to come and talk to us about it. However, we're happy you're free from FRS situation.
I think you can use the phone. My tracking device.
We'll be moving on.
Me, I only use earphones.
We'll take a quick break.
How are you, Chokwe?
I am very fine, as you did not let me to give you my gist, but we'll move on. I'm feeling myself. When we return.
Gist us now.
When we return, we'll review the news, the headline. We'll take the headline on the front pages. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back.
Welcome back, and thanks for staying tuned to us. We're starting off the front page review with the punch. Major headline. Obey court orders on Dasuki El-Zakzaki Sagetel's federal government. In other news, we are teaching Chibok girls to speak good English from the federal government. Ecological Fund. Jonathan never takes responsibility for anything, says El Rufai. EFCC seizes second property from Jonathan's godson. Afeniferi, IYC, kick as AGF says restructuring is a tall order. Ex-governor Adeleke dies of overdose, declares coroner.
Already it's over and over.
One feared dead as police navy clash in Calabar. Oshibajo signs bill to ease micro, small, and medium enterprise access to credit. And finally, drama as Lagos Khan backs Ambode's wife against sacked priest. So
I want to take that story on Lagos Khan, but it's in another newspaper.
Right? Let's talk about.
I'd like to take the headline in this one, or maybe the cheaper call.
The headline. Headline.
The headline.
What was the headline again?
Obey court orders.
Professor Ikse Sage, who is the chairperson, the presidential committee on anti-corruption, was saying to the federal government yesterday that they should obey court orders on the federal detainees. El Zakzaki is the leader of the Islamic Movement of Nigeria, IMN, and Dasuki, who was former NSA, to ex-president Jonathan. That, and this seems like a turnaround, because, Professor Sage has kept on saying they have questions to answer. Corruption is because people in the government aren't doing this. You can't allow high-profile detainees like this out of your sight, but he's making a U-turn.
This is because it was the NBA that brought this to him. He was addressing them and saying that the federal government henceforth should start to obey court orders, or they should go ahead, to question the orders holding these people, releasing those people.
Yeah, question the orders.
Appeal the orders.
Or appeal the orders, and they
don't just ignore it.
Spoke about the judges as well. Mm-hmm. He has agreed with the NBA on the judges that if you're not going to charge them.
Don't even taint their names.
Allow them to go about their
normal duties.
Because you're...
These things should be common sense. But I don't understand why it's not common.
That's one of the things I have against this government is their human rights
violation.
They really violate human rights.
Moving on to The Nation, major headline. Why restructuring wouldn't work now by federal government? It's possible, says San, others. Biafra Day shuts down Southeast. Sacked chaplain, Khan clears Ambode's wife. Olubado, I can't be intimidated, says Ajimobi. So what story are we going with?
The Khan story. So the Christian Association of Nigeria is supporting the sack of the chaplain of the... I'm trying to remember the name of the church.
Chapel of Christ the Light.
Christ Lights, which is a governmental, religious... institution is owned by the Lagos State government, to say that let Lagos State government, who hired, be the ones to fire. And if they have anything against the chaplain, don't politicize it. So they're saying leave Khan out of this, all right? Let the Lagos State, who hired him, be the ones to decide his fate. Mm-hmm.
Moving on to the Daily Sun, major headline. Aisha joins Buhari in UK. Fayose urges president to resign. Biafra, Southeast others shut down in compliance to sit-at-home order. You can't miss that picture. Obviously, you have the picture of a deserted, ever-busy Upper Iweka, Onitsha, Anambra State, ever-busy, but totally deserted. And then you have another picture of the Onitsha main market, also very deserted. And then you have the Refrigerator Plaza in Port Harcourt, River State. So this is Onitsha, Anambra State, and River State, all showing depiction of people conforming with the sit-at-home order. Government takes custody of Chibok girls, will help Nigeria rout Boko Haram terrorism, says Russia. Other news, Adeleke dies of drug overdose from the corona. Navy burns down police station. Corp killed in Calabar. No amount of agitation will cause restructuring, says federal government. And finally, Anambra North P People's Assembly endorses Obiano.
You can take the Navy, police clash in Calabar. The Nigerian police men were standing and stopped a Navy car by the road for flouting traffic, and they had a clash. The Navy guys beat up the policeman. Whoa. And they arrested them and took them into the
traffic
police station.
It was actually a traffic warden.
They beat him up, and so the police arrested them and took them into the police station. Was got to the Navy barracks that they had been arrested, and they came back in a reprisal attack, and shot at policemen,
burnt
the police station, burnt houses, killed some. In the reports, conflicting reports were saying one person died. Some were saying a lot of people died.
Up to
10 people.
Yeah, but I just wanted to say they first beat the yellow fever.
Exactly.
Then a policeman came to intervene and stop fighting. They joined that one inside the beating.
And they burnt down a police station.
They thought that everything was over when around 8 p.m. they came back.
Now, this is a case of battle of supremacy between security agencies. It is the norm.
Their own area, which is over the waterways.
They are not even.
It is the Nigerian police duty to ensure free traffic, to ensure security within a state. And when they are doing their duty, we have this supremacy battle where when a person is in military uniform or another uniform, they are above the law.
Esprit de corps.
You see?
It's terrible.
They must remember that we're in democracy.
Exactly.
Navy, army, barracks.
That's all.
It's police that we know.
The only way to deter this...
It is when there is a situation of maybe war or militancy that maybe come out. And they come to the water, not land.
Yes.
So right now we need the naval officers to speak up.
They are waiting to call them. Chief of Naval Staff.
But this is the only paper that has the story of Aisha joining Buhari in UK.
The story I read says that after 23 days of the president staying in the UK, his wife yesterday went to the UK with him,
to join him.
Governor Fire, she's asking for his resignation. Nigerians are saying that if you cannot tell us exactly what the issue is, this secrecy doesn't help the nation.
Because his health is being supported, is being funded by the federal government.
Yes.
At least, in the very minimum, we should know what he's been.
Taxpayers'
money. So we need to know what we are paying for.
It's not just taxpayers'
money. To a large extent. It's
our commonwealth.
It's our commonwealth. That's the word.
Vanguard.
Billions. And please, I just have to comment here because the healthcare system is very poor here.
Mm-hmm.
And our president is not going through the healthcare system. He's now going abroad.
Will the healthcare system change?
Moving on to Vanguard. Biafra sit at home, which is why people are agitating. Total shutdown in Southeast. Partial shutdown in Port Harcourt, Asaba, Umuahia. Armed security agencies force out people in a Ebonyi. Okorocha goes around, begs traders to open shop. It's a huge success. IPOB, Masob, Nwazurike, hails Ndigbo. And Vanguard has a detailed picture of five states and how it was deserted.
Let's quickly go about...
We need to talk about this.
The Biafran agitation. They are serious.
We need to listen to them.
I think that the federal government holding Nnamdi Kanu for almost 2 years...
He just worsened it.
They made him a hero for his people. Because they now say... You know that one of his conditions was that he mustn't be in a garden of more than 9 people. Now he has spoken to his people. They're listening to him. This stay at home was such a success that
they should take notes.
Needs to go and start talking to them.
The Daily Times. Telkom confirms ZTE. Telkom firm ZTE flouts immigration laws. Has about 60% expatriates with questionable business visas. And IPOB sit at home order, Southeast Rivers Delta's others comply.
You have a story.
Yes, right? I have this ZTE story where 70% of their staff, they're expatriates, and we have a law that says that any foreign country, company that comes into the country must employ local labor.
So even the 70%, 60% of that 70% have issues with their visas. So... make money, government. That's all we can take on front page review for today.
We
up next,
to this day at all.
NYC to deploy core members to farm later on Let's Talk. We talk to a motivational guest, takes the couch. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. The Director General of the National Youth Service Corps, Brigadier General Suleiman Kazaure, said that the scheme will soon begin to post corps members to farms. According to the report, the move to deploy core members to farms was in line with the agricultural development program of the NYSC. Also, the NYSC has concluded preparations to begin the posting at the conclusion of the 3 weeks orientation exercise. What are your thoughts on this? It's Your View. You can let it count. Call us to join the conversation at 070-8066-8014, or you can tweet to us at TVC Connect using the hashtag YourViewTVC. So, we are lucky we did not save, because if not, we'll have been farming at this time. We're not saving at this time.
No, but the two sides to the story make sense, actually. On this one, I'm in between, because the people who study agricultural science never saw a farm. So if you deploy such people to farms, there's a reason somebody would choose agri. Right?
That wasn't specified in the research, though.
So the other side of this is that if you now send somebody who studied medicine to a farm, what are you doing, Gongong? What's the sense in that?
Because I know someone I met one-on-one about last year. She said that she's a secondary school girl. She just finished secondary school. She said they had an excursion in Lagos State Secondary School, public secondary school, to the farms in Ekpe. Mm-hmm. And it was detailed. They broke down the potentials of farming and everything. She said when she finished, she went back to meet her parents and said, I want to be a farmer. When I spoke to her, she said she wanted to be a farmer, and I was wondering why. She said, I took a tour. I see the business opportunities. My grandfather, I remember they have a farm. He has a farm in the village, and I want to take over that farm. And, you know, for me, that is a better policy. It's subtle. It's not imposing. Mm. It was just an excursion, exposing the children to the advantages.
To the opportunities.
And the opportunities.
Yeah.
You see, rather than imposition of go to the farm.
I think there are pros and cons on for this
scheme.
You see, it is good for us to know about farming, but I think they should be careful about imposing it, because it's not everybody that has a green finger.
Yeah,
you know. So I don't think I have green fingers. So if you send me for farming, you will just...
It's a waste of my time and effort.
Well, okay, so you never know your hidden talent.
You see, the thing is, in secondary school, you can actually start it from secondary school. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't mention the Chibok girls today when they said that they're going back to learn English. And I know that these girls were doing
WAEC.
Science and everything.
Do they do WAEC in Hausa?
They don't.
So how would they have passed their WAEC? So already the education from the secondary school level has flaws.
Yes.
It has serious flaws.
True.
Now, I remember in secondary school, they used to make us
go to the farm. Yes.
Yes. I was my first experience cutting grass.
Yes.
You would cut, so you take a portion and you start cutting all the way down.
There are things that I think Ministry of Education can actually do from secondary school level.
Yes.
So now when you now go into your youth service, you can decide,
I want to
be the farmer type. I want to be the office type. It's not everybody that's going to be a farmer now.
The policy is not totally useless, because
it's not.
Some people would never know. You know, the exposure that most Nigerian students have is that you go to school and you carry that your certificate, that's your white collar, make sure you get a white collar job, and that's the only way you're successful. So if some people need harsh reality, someone to turn them, you know, drastically
track. Or just even expose them.
The exposure, they need to get it, and for some it has to be drastic.
So 3 weeks
and such
after.
Measure is important, because you see, when people, that's why I'm afraid, Nigerian students will protest this. They will resist it in a way that they don't want to get posted to an area where they have land safe. Everybody wants to come to Lagos.
Yes,
now so
bank.
That they will not have land.
Yes,
everybody
now.
Wants to work in the bank. And you're a copper, you don't want to get down and dirty. you want to just, you know, walk
true,
it.
Because Femi's adopted son, he's graduated. He can't wait to be posted out of Lagos. He can't wait.
That's an adventurous person.
No, but what you see,
but you see, you have 3 months first before you go into the office where you are jumping and...
Three weeks.
Either 3 weeks, expose them to the farming.
Yeah, so let them make their decisions.
They can make their decisions from there.
True.
There was a time that everybody was sent to the teaching.
Exactly.
How has that improved the quality of teachers we have?
Excuse me.
We've seen cases of
abuse.
It's
not the quality of teachers alone.
How has that improved?
It has improved. It has given people options for jobs. Teaching was a job once upon a time nobody wanted.
Also, everybody, now, we have
exactly,
more teachers now.
We have more
they don't get retained
you get
now.
People, no, you get people graduating now. I had a friend, when I served, Aisha served with me. And I remember that because she insisted on being posted to a school. Mm-hmm. And now today she runs a school. She has her own school because of that exposure.
She wanted to be
she
there.
Wanted to, no, she insisted on being posted to a school.
She runs a school now. I wanted to be posted to a school and I was to go and teach chemistry. Mass comm graduate. Which kind of chemistry was I supposed to
Ooh,
teach?
Deploy
we have a call, Musa from Abuja. Let's get his views on this. Welcome to the show, Musa. Good morning. Good morning, Musa. Are you there?
Hello, good morning.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. I just want to make a comment on the topic you're discussing.
Mm-hmm. Please, fire on.
Okay. I believe that, well, first and foremost, I'm a first-time caller.
Welcome to the show.
Secondly, I'd like to say that this is a good policy as far as I'm concerned because, look, without even a policy, the harsh reality of life today is forcing so many people back
to
home. Now, so if the NYSA is kind enough to look into the future and to help young Nigerians who would have otherwise never had this opportunity to take them to farms and give them tutorials on how to work on the farm. I think these wonderful ladies on set today are probably using their mindset from 20 years and 25 years ago to look at the reality of today. The ones graduating from universities today are certainly not your age mate. Don't look at your own time and think, oh, if I was posted to a farm, how would I respond to it? My suggestion is this, that everybody should be given an opportunity. Those ones that have green fingers, like our sister said, would discover themselves at the end of 1 year. Mm. They can now take a decision. Like one of you said, somebody was taken to a farm mm-hmm. in Ogun State. Mm-hmm. And thereafter, she made a decision. That's because she was exposed to the opportunity.
Yeah.
Now, see the 1 year as an opportunity for every young man. By the way, I have only recently decided to go on commercial farming myself. Now, this is the reality of Nigeria. All civil servants, you see, most civil servants, over 80% of them, in most of our metropolises, have farms around the big towns that
the agro revolution
and people please, and the teachers all over teachers and health workers that are into all the remote areas in this country, they cannot but support themselves with their own farm producers to be able to make ends meet. This is a very good opportunity for young people to be given the reorientation, and we're talking about diversifying the economy. Who are the people
who will do that?
Thank you, Musa. We're not doing sciences. If you want to diversify our economy, innovation. See, everything that we need, we import because we do not have an educational structure that encourages people learning to do these things.
Okay.
So even the agric, our tractors, do we make any in Nigeria?
No.
So everything we do is just empowering other countries.
Can I take some tweets?
Some countries have technology. That is what they have.
Mm.
We, once upon a time, before the oil boom,
we had
agriculture.
So we want to go back there?
Yes, we can. Why can't we?
We do.
Why can't we?
We have the population.
The world population is growing every day. Why can't we export agriculture? Can't we export food?
We can. Listen, but you just can't force anyone.
So you cannot. Okay, let me tell you something surprising. As a child, as a 12-year-old, I had a farm. Even though someone stole my beans at the end of the day, I didn't harvest them. But I had a farm and I know I have a green finger. Maybe today now I'm thinking, where can I get land? Where can I do this? Where can I do that? Those are the opportunities we should be asking government to
there
make.
There is a value chain. There's an agro value chain. There's an agro value chain. It's not about those that go and farm in the farm.
Exactly.
There's a value chain.
Processing.
There's processing.
Transportation. Preservation. Don't send us to the farm and forget
the
about the rest.
The president just signed an executive
micro
order.
And small, medium businesses.
This is what we're talking. It is that chain.
Core members should not be coerced into farming. It should be optional. Mm-hmm. TO says TBH. What does TBH mean? If I had a choice between to teach and farm, I'd be sure to choose farming. On the long run, I'd be better off. MW Pearl says, there are pros and cons, but I would have suggested making it voluntary rather than imposing it on everyone.
Yeah.
There's another angle I want to bring on this issue.
They should add an incentive to it.
They
should add an incentive where people who are willing to go into this will get higher allowances or something to encourage it. No, that's...
I get
because
you.
Because even if it's not
makes
for
sense.
Large scale... For self-subsistence farming,
no.
This reality that we're in now.
To feed yourself.
Nima, we have a lot of subsistence farming. The issue we have is that we need to do on a grand, bigger scale industrial farming.
I will not agree. I will take this one. Dada Olowoye says, is it the kind of farm our grandfathers and grandmothers got calloused hands tilling day and night?
Yes, because somebody was saying that we see farming as cutlass and
hoes.
So how many acres of land can you farm
and
with cutlass?
How many tractors?
Are they sending them to do mechanized farming?
How many tractors has the NYSC Corps people gotten
Until
together?
Until we see this policy...
Say it is me with this kind of nail, they will say
we
I should not farm.
You see, the thing about it is, farming is very key to sustenance of any population. But there are other industries too. Make sure that our educational system exposes all of us to them so that we make our decision.
Can I just tell you something?
We'll be talking more about Agric. Because our speaker, the person that is coming to talk to us, our motivational guest, is also into Agric, and we don't have time to take your comments now.
I just want to tell you that farmers are the richest people in Europe.
Thank you.
And America. No!
We'll take a break. We'll talk more about farming, about this type of farming and the industrial type of farming. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
I'm not saying that.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. Still on agriculture, we've seen many young people striving to leave Nigeria for greener pastures abroad. This 27-year-old saw the opportunities in Nigeria and decided to return to his homeland to nurse it. Timmy will be sharing with us his journey from relocating to Nigeria and to becoming the founding partner of one of Nigeria's growing agro businesses. Welcome to the show, Timmy.
Thank you for having me.
We're excited.
I'm excited to be
so,
here.
So, we've been discussing agriculture.
Okay.
You studied abroad.
Yes.
You saw an agric opportunity and came back home. Would you have made the same decision if you were sort of forced or coerced into becoming a farmer?
If I was forced, I probably would not have made it because it wouldn't be that attractive.
Oh, thank you, my dear.
If I was forced, I would probably not do that because it wouldn't be that attractive to me. But for me, agriculture has always been something I've always wanted to do. Mm. I mean, right from my undergraduate days, I always had flash drives. I had Timmy's Agric folders where I was always collecting information about agriculture. And it's when I look back now, it's funny how I'm just where I am right now, doing what I always thought I was going to do.
Okay. Timmy, so, yeah, I want you to inspire us by telling us how you decided what to go into in agri, because, you know, the wide ranges. How did you
choose?
The value
chain.
How did he even choose that? Okay, oh, is a hibiscus flower? That's me I want to do.
Okay, first of all, we don't do only hibiscus. We do hibiscus and we do ginger as well.
Oh,
but wow. In the early stages,
you didn't bring the ginger.
I didn't bring the ginger, unfortunately, because we don't package it as attractive as this. Oh. I was like, yeah. Well, in the early stages, I always thought I was going to do palm oil. Because the state where I'm from, palm oil was grown excessively there. And I always thought, you know what, I'm going to bring palm oil and I'm going to export Ekiti State. I'm from Ekiti State. Yeah, so I always thought I was going to do palm oil. And you know, at that time, I was working at a bank and I was looking for how to bring my palm oil in, because I used to go to the African stores in the city where I lived then, and I used to see the margins on palm oil, and I was like, you know what, palm oil is it for me.
They're making a killing.
Yeah, they're making a killing. I'm like, do you know what, 25 litres, look at how much they're selling. But I spoke to one day, I used to be really, really bored and restless at work, and then at any point in time, even when I was working for a bank, if you come to my computer screen and open the tabs, you would always see agriculture Google searches, you know. And I spoke to my brother one day. He was working for a tech company back in Nigeria then, and you know, I was like, how can we bring this palm oil into
is
the
is that
UK?
Your brother then?
Yeah, that's him.
Oh, nice.
In the heart, yeah. And he was like, you know what, how can we bring this thing? And he was like, you know what, Baba, calm down. There's this thing called hibiscus flower, Zobo. Like, there's demand and there's excessive demand for it in Europe and in Latin America. Mm. And you know, and the great thing is with agriculture now, there's the internet, there's so much information. Mm-hmm. So I went on LinkedIn, I went on all the groups I could go on, discussions, and I kept looking at it. And lo and behold, there was demand for it, you know. And then at that point in time, Sudan was the highest exporter, Sudan and Senegal. And then, but then there was increasing demand in Nigerian hibiscus.
Yes,
so we started to research it, and then Zobo. And then
the processing. You know, because a lot of people are worried. One of the things that, one of the issues we have with agriculture in Nigeria is we have abundance of everything, mm-hmm. but then they get spoiled because we don't have a proper preservation. We don't have a preservation maintainer or culture. We don't preserve anything. It's just we get into the season, it's abundant. Then we are out of season and it finishes. So what's the process for preserving this, and how do you now package it for export? What exactly do you do?
You know, when people talk about agriculture as well, like I tell people, it's not just famine.
Mm.
There's like a lot of, there's the full value chain. So there's agricultural process, there's agriculture, there's famine, which is great. Mm. You can earn money from that. There's agricultural storage, which is a multi-billion naira, you know, industry on its own.
Mm.
And then there's agricultural processing, and then there's agricultural export.
Mm.
So, I mean, we looked at it, and then initially we started with just processing it. We were trying to get sifting and trying to get the specifications of different countries. But over time, you know, we started to look at storage. You know, how can we make this thing available even during off-season?
Yeah.
And that's when you earn margins, you know, all year round. And then, I mean, we were able, and there's agricultural technology as well. I mean, we've worked with lecturers in, you know, universities to find out how we can even preserve and store these things, you know, the right storage techniques to use, the kind of ways we should sort our warehouse out to make sure that it's available all year round, and it's the value chain is attractive.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to ask, you said hibiscus, is this that red hibiscus that we
the flower,
is it?
It's slightly different. This one is more, it's called Sabdarifa, so it's slightly different in appearance.
I wanted to ask, because this is the tea I'm drinking, and it's...
Yes, it's amazing.
In fact, you have to show for us so that we can be drinking it.
Hey. I mean, well, I can do that.
Well, I kidnapped
this
bag.
Actually,
you're taking it, YK?
She's taking it.
That's what she's having. I don't, well, you
it's
know, having
it. It's not too sweet. And the more it's soaking in the water, the more it's becoming, you know. And can you eat it as a snack? Because I ate some.
People do. I don't, but people do. I mean, to be honest, I was recently researching on it, and I saw that some company where we export to, they've turned this into like ice popsicles.
Really?
Whoa.
Yeah, so there's like Zobo popsicles for kids where you can literally just suck on Zobo lollipops, you know.
To the main question, how did you get funding to start? How expensive is it to start this?
Yeah, well, to be honest, funding for any entrepreneur, especially when you're starting out, is challenging. You know, access to credit was challenging for us. And not even just access to credit, because people say access to credit. The cost of credit as well. Because I'm in an industry where the margins are not so high. So sometimes when even banks, we do have a couple of banks who've offered us, and then when you look at the margins and the interest, it doesn't make sense. But you have to be creative. And then what we did was, okay, let's crowdfund. We have a purchase order. Let's go to this bank or this company. Let's go to their cooperative. Let's show them, and let's be transparent. Let's just tell them, you know what, you can crowdfund 10 containers for us. Mm. You make this, we make this. It's a win-win. Mm. Let's do that.
That's
what we did, you know. Yeah. We crowdfunded contracts. And then over time, what we
did... So you built your order.
We built the order. And when we went to crowdfund, and then the fact that we were able to execute those contracts, we were able to go back to the clients and say, you know, not even... Because the banks, the margins never really added up for us. We went back to the clients and said... We executed this. In the next contract, can you give us an advance?
Oh, nice.
And that's how we worked it out.
You have a BSc in economics and a master's in international business. Yeah. Nigeria needs you to get out of recession with your expertise. My question, you knew, you know, that you wanted to do agri. Yeah. Why did you go and do economics and international business? Was that to foster whenever you go into agri to do the business properly? Or
well, to be honest, the age where I was when I made the decision to do economics, I wasn't at an age where I could literally make the decision. I didn't have enough information. Mm. So literally, you know what happens when you're in secondary school? Everyone is just filling a form. Mm. Yeah. What did you fill on the form? Economics? Like, oh yeah, economics.
Were you very brilliant in school? Because you look...
I think I'm quite, you know.
Oh, above average.
Quite above average. I would like to think so. My lecturers might think otherwise, but I was a bit playful as well, but I mean, yeah.
I mean, can you show me?
Yeah. So, I wanted to ask about this because, you see, we tend to focus on export. I know we want the dollars to come in, but why don't we get to the point where we refine it to the point you have a tea bag, like we're buying... your company's tea bag, you build a brand. Mm. So I'm buying your tea bag. Fantastic and in question. Nigeria, we are all consuming made in Nigeria, locally produced, start to finish tea bags.
From Timi, okay.
Wouldn't that be, is that in line with what your, do you have that in your plan?
Yeah, it's in the plan, because when we started Agorec, now it's me, my best friend and my elder brother, what we wanted was an agricultural hub. That did everything, processed, exported agricultural technology. We wanted the first of its kind agricultural hub. And we export now because, I mean, there are good margins when you export. But if you're going to do a tea bag and all that, you need to sort of import machinery. And you pay for that in
That's
dollars,
what she was saying, that we need engineers.
Yeah, so
we don't just need farmers. We need engineers that would fabricate everything.
Yeah, we do have great engineers that have built us local stuff, and it's great. It works. Yeah. But, I mean, if you want to be competitive as well, you're going to have to import machinery at some point in time.
Yeah.
And right now, I mean, if I did, let's assume I sold this locally and I earned in Naira, it's not very profitable to change to buy US.
So this is actually, it's all for export.
Right now we don't sell in the local market. We're looking at it, we're trying to introduce some interesting brands,
At 27, fantastic. It's wedding next. Aleogo is calling us. Yeah, welcome to the show.
Come on.
I'll package all of my yoga sisters for you. Aleogo, welcome to the show.
She's an only child.
Good morning. Hello, are you there? Good morning.
Yeah, good morning.
Yes, welcome to the show.
Yeah, good morning. We're talking about NYC posting to become a farmer.
We've actually moved away from that.
You do have government in the first place. Nigeria has failed us, and you want to post our youth, copper, for X-Men to be killing them?
Help me, oh.
You want to post our coppers? Let that DG, the Director General, NYC, to post his children.
Bam!
This attitude is not helping.
I was watching 4 days
ago. This attitude will not help us.
I was watching 4 days ago. Why a VC, a Vice Chancellor, of university, his children were graduating abroad. None of them went to school here. Now the DG wants to send our children to NYC for henchmen to kill. As we are talking today in Lagos State, no plantain to eat. We have local
Because it's not in season.
We have states. Where are the preservation they have done? What have they done for us? Nothing. So before you think about putting our children to farming,
send your own children.
Which farm is it? Is there any farm owned by government?
Let me read one tweet to you. Only the kind of farm you grow bad back, hunchback, bald, suffering.
I don't get
it. It is this attitude that us where we are today. We found distasteful what our parents did. back in the days as a child, my grandfather used to harvest from the farm and they would bring yam to Lagos. They had a preservative method, traditional preservative for their yams. Today we don't have it. All my cousins are selling lands in the village.
Go and join the Nima, you're a lawyer. Go to the farm. We are going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll continue this conversation. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Welcome back. So we'll take a question from Jumoke.
Based on what Nima was saying, I was going to mention that I remember very well our pounding machine in Nigeria, the professor in then University of Ife, a scientist who came up with this machine at the time, went to the Federal Ministry of Science and Technology that I have this invention, but I need government support. He said, people pound yam with mortar and pestle now. Who is going to buy a machine? He carried his invention outside the country. It was funded in the UK. We are now importing that machine. So government needs to do the right thing. Before you start sending us to farm, Timmy, please advise. Your business as it is, you're an economist.
Yeah.
And
what's the government's input?
What does the government need to do? Because we know they don't, are not doing anything.
Well, before you answer, please, let's take this phone call.
All right.
Medinat from Iwaya, welcome to the show. Good morning.
Good morning.
I wish
to support any match on this topic.
I need it right now.
We need to have somebody to go back to agriculture, and these coppers are the best to go with. So now, let's change our orientation and our attitude towards this one. We can't be fed by Ghanaians. We have to do it by ourselves.
Let's encourage them.
If we need some compensation in place to do that for them, let's do it. This is what we are saying. We don't want our children to do it. Are we going to get foreigners to do it for us?
We agree with you, Medina.
We are not against farming.
Abby?
You are the one thinking we are against it.
We believe in it.
We believe in it, but we are saying don't force them.
Uh-huh. See me? So please answer the question about government.
What do you want government to do? What do you think government can do?
I think when it comes to government, obviously there's the challenge of credit facilities, which is a bit cumbersome to get. Because I know about the export stimulation facility, which is what the government just started. And the process, sometimes you don't even get information on how to go about it. Even when you've completed your applications, I mean, sometimes in months, you don't even know whether it's rejected, it's pending, it's accepted.
Imagine.
So you can't even make decisions. But aside that, I think government needs to re-engage the youth. You know, before you bring out a policy to say, okay, go back to farming, have a sit down with the youth.
God bless you.
You know, how do you want to participate? It needs to be policy. We need to participate in the policy that involves agriculture. And when I say re-engage the youth, it has to move away from farming. Farming is farming, yeah. Few people would say 2-3 degrees are just going to go back and take a cutlass and farm.
Exactly.
But you need to re-engage them with information and say it's more than farming, there's processing, there's storage. Do you understand? There's way more to it than just, you know.
I'll ask you about how you deal with farmers, but we have a phone call from Shegun. We have Shegun from Lekki. Welcome to the show. Good morning.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
Welcome to the show. So you have a question for Femi? For Timmy?
No. I do not have a question. I just want to contribute to what has been going on.
Go ahead.
And to let you know what I noticed. First of all, I'm not really too happy that Moraya is not on set today because the four of you, the four ladies in the studio there, are talking and acting as if you guys are anti-government. And if Moraya had been around, she will have actually moderated this thing very well.
So please say your own view.
I don't know when this program has turned to anti-government program. I think we need to be conscious.
It is your view, sir.
And so because they are watching, they will also pick up from where you say. It is not everything you read in the paper that you start echoing, you know, to us, you know, at home. Because we will feel government is like that and government is not good. So let's change our orientation.
Whatever policies
that have come on board, please, as you are on set, it is an opportunity for you to actually make government work, for you to let us at home know that, look, government is not totally useless. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Segun. So you, I wanted to ask you, you answered yours. I wanted to ask you about how you deal with farmers, because you are not into the tilling of the soil by yourself. You buy this product off.
You source it.
You source it. Where do you source from, and how do you deal with them? And is it always available? So that's like a three-in-one question.
It's not always available, to be honest. But what we tried to do when we started it, we literally just bought from suppliers, and then, you know, we exported, we processed and exported. But over time now, we've started backward integration. So what we try to do is to finance farmers. Right. And then when we finance farmers, when they harvest, sure, we just buy it off them.
Okay.
And it's not as straightforward as or as easy as it is, because contract farming is, it's a very difficult thing to do. Because first of all, the farmers don't, when you go into a contract with someone, you're supposed to go into a contract with someone who is a bit literate. But when you go into a contract with people that don't really understand the terms of the contract, in their own mind is like, okay, well, our contract was we will buy at this amount per ton. This person is offering me this amount per ton. Take
and
your
so
money
they just
back.
Sell. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, it's like, and we're like, no, 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 we finance, you pre-finance, and you know, he's not, he's just telling you, what are you saying? And okay, so obviously there has to be, yeah, it's sometimes contracts are literally make no sense, because wow, yeah, but we've had our ups and downs, and then we've been able to sort of like hold some people to the contract farming. So yeah, literacy is something that the government needs to even look into and say, okay, this is a famine, they need to be literate, they need to understand the meaning of a contract. Mm-hmm. They need to understand that if these people have signed contracts with,
how about power?
You, you see, power is another thing that is, I mean, that's a different, that's a totally different subject. Yeah, but I mean, power is something that is important.
I'd like
as
you
well
to encourage.
So you don't farm yourself, you just go and buy,
yes,
it off the farmer.
Now we finance, we actually finance, because you cannot process if the goods are not available.
Yeah.
And you cannot, so what we try to do now is to just ensure it is available, and
so
by financing
farmers.
So we
have just 1 minute left, and I want you to use that opportunity to reach out to that 27-year-old, that 21-year-old that is thinking of what to do. How can they go into this? How can you encourage them?
Well, I mean, if you decide this is what you want to do, you just have to, you have to be brave about it, because the support is probably not going to come from government. The support is not going to come from other people in the industry, but you just have to be brave about it, and you have to learn to do the simple things well, because over time what we found out is, especially when you're exporting, a lot of it is built on trust, and you know, your clients have to trust you, the people you do business with, they have to trust you, and the only way they trust you is if you consistently do the little things well, the simple things, you know. The finance will eventually come if you have a track record. You know, a lot of things will eventually come together. And then also, you partnership, you have to be sensible about the people you partner with.
Jumoke will take a few tweets and then we'll round off.
Sensei says, this is another reason why orientation camps are needed, for not just parades and drills and speeches. Temitope and he says, have they made provisions for good instruments? What happened to our gold and crude oil? Emmanuel says, no big deal if it is mechanized way, 100% support. Sensei again saying that NYC sets farming for coppers, so also should other sectors be put in place for work also. And
on that note, Ward Randolph, I know one of the things you kept saying was that you research. So if we're going to leave anything with all our viewers, is that whatever industry you want to go into, research.
We're not saying everybody
information.
Should
you might, whatever industry, whichever whatever you decide to do, research. Focus on the little things and do it to the best of your capacity. I hope you've been inspired by our guests today and motivated into seeing the opportunities within our shores. Till we see you again tomorrow, enjoy the rest of your day. Bye bye.